And welcome to Matt Nair on Air. Thank you so very much for joining us. Jane Matt Nair, Greg Bach, Dr. Slide on the board. You can always join us at 844-967-2789, 844-96-PARTY. Or leave a comment on the live stream if you're watching on Facebook, YouTube, and or Twitter. Coming up at 11:50, just confirmed with our sports reporter, Mike Clemens. He is going to be joining us at 11:50. Lots of big sports news. We started off last hour with the news that the Bucks have hired Doc Rivers as head coach, and the Packers have fired Joe Barry. So Mike will be joining us to break that all down coming up at 11:50. Big news in sports. Also big news in many different ways. Our next guest has been with the Milwaukee County Zoo for 26 years. Jenny Deliberti, thank you so very much for joining us. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you. How are you?
We're great. We're very excited to have you here. We're going to get to your big news in a little bit, but I wanted to talk first of all about the obvious and growing influence of the Penguin lobby over the Groundhog lobby. What is going on with Groundhog Day and the Penguins are taking over?
Right. The Penguins are taking over. It can be controversial, but I think most people are happy about it. I think if people remember years ago, we didn't have a groundhog, so we switched to our polar bear, Snow Lily, and she took over the duties. Unfortunately, Snow Lily passed away a couple of years ago. So we thought what would be the next best animal other than a groundhog, because right now we don't have a groundhog. Gordy had passed away shortly after last year's ceremony. So we got to thinking, penguins have a huge following at our zoo. We have a lot of zoo fans that come for the penguins.
Awesome.
And our warm weather penguins are the first thing that people see when they walk through the front entrance.
Right.
So we decided they could take over the duties. And so news to them, their animal care staff has been working with them on some training. So they'll be ready for the big day next week.
How does that
I love this so much.
How does that even work, Jenny? So how is this going to work if they all come out and see a shadow? Or what is going to be the determining factor for how long of a winter we're going to have?
Sure. So I think what the idea is, some of the training is at night now, they're ushered into their burrow, which is kind of that big sort of rock work that you see. So they're ushered in there, which is nice and warm. It's about 55 degrees in there. So they're practicing. They're practicing to stay indoors for the evening. And then the keepers are opening up the burrow for them to come out to practice. We think it's going to be one penguin leading the rest of the penguins out. So it'll be a flock of penguins. And as you said, they'll be making their prediction based on if they see their shadows or not.
That is hilarious, Jenny. I think I can't even imagine the meetings that you had at the zoo. It's like, I don't know. You don't have a groundhog. How are you feeling about penguins? I don't know. What about an elk?
Have you gotten pushback from groundhog purists?
Well, not yet, but interesting.
Give it time.
I was going to say, we did get a little pushback from the enthusiasts the last time when we used Snow Lily. But then when they saw, you know, we had school kids here, we had the county executive here. When they saw what, you know, a big deal it was, they were okay with it. So hopefully it'll follow this year that they won't be too upset.
This is what's wrong with America now. Back when I was a kid, it was groundhogs. Now they got bears and they got penguins. Next thing you know, humans will be doing it.
Because it's a completely scientific diagnosis and prediction on how many more weeks of winter we're going to have. So this is going to happen on February 2nd. What time are all the festivities, Jenny, if people want to go?
So they're going to start at 9 o'clock. So that is before the zoo opens. So we will let our visitors know afterwards. We'll have it on video. So we'll place that on our social media platforms soon after the penguins make the prediction. And our zoo director is going to be here for that, as well as the county executive, David Crowley, to help make the prediction as well.
I love that so much. I really do.
Me too.
And I love that penguins, and certainly, as you said, Jenny, when you walk into the Milwaukee County Zoo, that is one of the big displays that you see offhand. But there is something about penguins that is so adorable.
They're just
and so endearing.
Fun.
It is. And, you know, from, you know, just their appearance, like you say, the way they waddle, you know, when they lose their feathers, they don't look that great. Feathers come back in, they porpoise through the water, which means they kind of jump around into the water. And like I say, we have just a lot of visitors that not only come to see them, but it's the kind of exhibit that you can kind of hang out at and they'll be doing different things. Mm-hmm. I was just walking past their exhibit a few minutes ago and they're all out getting fed from a zookeeper's hands. You know what I mean? It's like, they have a great life here. So we're excited to showcase them.
So, and like when you work in, I'm not saying where you work is abnormal, but when you work in a traditional office, you walk past things all the time. There's Deb in accounting, counting away. Oh, look, there's Steve in marketing, doing the marketing stuff. But when you walk from one part of your job to another, you're going to pass all these gorgeous, beautiful animals. In all the years you've been there, how many times have you been walking and all of a sudden you just stop dead in your feet just to watch and you realize, oh, I'm going to be late because the gorillas are amazing.
Right. And I have to say that even, you know, I've been here so long, over 25 years, and I still stop and it's still, yeah. It never has gotten old to me because I've always loved animals. I love our, you know, mission of conservation and like you say, you know, seeing the animals or even going into one of the kitchens, like the big cat kitchen,
yeah.
You'll see, oh, Katie's in there and she's bringing out a frozen oxtail for the lions. Of course she is. You know what I mean? Like you say, and we joke internally.
Yeah.
Where else can you work that you're going to see some of these things? It's just, it's awesome.
I'm so jealous. I would love to work at the zoo.
Well, you can always apply if people are interested, right, Jenny?
Oh, for sure. Any open positions at the zoo would be listed on the website from Milwaukee County Department of Human Resources. And we do have volunteers here as well. Even though a lot of times they don't work directly with the animals, you're still in that environment, like you say, and you get to know, you know, oh, we have a new tiger in or we have a new gorilla in. Just, you know, kind of being on the, I guess, inside scoop on a lot of our animals and what we're doing here, which has been, for me, it's been best job I've ever had. So I love it.
Well, and now I guess is as good a time as any. And when I reached out to you to talk about the penguins and the growing influence of the penguin lobby, and you mentioned to me that after more than 25 years, you are going to retire.
I am.
Congratulations.
Thank you. I, it's, you know, really bittersweet. Because like I say, we were just talking in a staff meeting earlier and it's like, those years have gone so fast for me. And I think, you know, when you're doing something that you love, I feel like, oh my God, if anybody finds out I'm getting paid for this, what I'm doing, you know what I mean?
It's right. Like, right. They're going to ask for their money back.
Right. And so I've learned so much and, you know, gotten to know the animal care staff, the veterinarians, you know, and then the regular people like us, the accountants and the, you know, president and, you know, all the way on down the line. But it's a really unique place to work. And, you know, we've often found that zoos throughout the country are very collaborative. So whenever we have questions about our animals or health concerns, a lot of times other zoos step up and help us as we help the other zoos. So it's just, it was a great environment for me and I'm going to miss it.
Well, after all of those years, I can't even imagine the number of different stories you must have.
Yeah.
I can remember, and I don't remember how many years ago it was, Jenny. It must be about 4 or 5 years ago that you and I went and did a little behind the scenes at the zoo, and you drove me around in the golf cart, and we got to go into the, it was like the elk building. And right. One of the things I thought was so cool is that the keepers and the animal trainers get to name new baby animals, and a lot of them will use family names.
Oh my gosh, yes.
Which I think is, I love that.
Look, there's Fritz the llama.
Right. Right. And I mean, really, it's a credit to them because they spend so much time with these animals that isn't it right that they get to name them? And it's interesting because we have a new director of animal management and health. Her name is Tracy Dolphin.
Her last name is Dolphin?
What?
It is. Right. And she works with one of our curators of large mammals, and his name is Tim Wild.
Oh, nice.
Like, you can't make this up,
you
right?
Can't.
Is your president's last name Zoo? I mean, this is amazing.
It should be. But, you know, Tracy worked here as an elephant keeper about 16 years ago. And then she went to, you know, another zoo, met her husband, had kids. Now she's back. And, you know, to hear her stories where we were talking about a giraffe that was born in 1998. Her name was Sky, and she had to be hand-raised by some of the keepers, including Tracy. And Tracy said, and you know, Sky was named after her niece, who is now in her 30s. You know what I mean? I'm like, that's right. You know what I mean? All these different stories, like you say, whether it's the care that these animals get, the fact that a lot of them go on to other zoos to maybe start their own families. It's just on and on and on. That I could share some stories with you.
Well, if you have time, we'd love to keep you for another segment.
Sure.
And we can talk about some of the wild things that happened behind
I see
the
what
scenes
you did there.
At the Milwaukee County Zoo. If you have a question for Jenny, you can always call or text 844-967-2789. Stay close. You're listening to Matt and Air on Air, coming to you across the Civic Media Radio Network. Welcome to Matt and Air on Air. Thank you so very much for joining us. Jane, Matt and Air, Greg Bach, and the sound surgeon Calvin on the board, coming to you live.
Oh my God.
From our studio in beautiful downtown Waukesha. You can always join us. You can call, you can text at 844-967-2789 or leave a comment on the live stream if you're watching on Facebook, YouTube, and or Twitter. Our special guest from the Milwaukee County Zoo, one of the best zoos in the country, Jenny Deliberti, is here talking about some backstage stories, what happens in the dark at the zoo. We had Andrew from Maine who texted in Jenny, and he said, I bet 60% of Jenny's day is admiring animals, 30% is running late to meetings, and 10% is trying to remember where you were going before you got distracted.
Oh my gosh, how true, right? And we have such a large animal collection here. We have over 2,200 different animals and 350 different species. So it's a lot.
It is a lot.
I think, like you say, people, you know, have really, in Milwaukee and surrounding communities, have really had an affinity for this zoo. It's a hometown zoo. But then again, you know, we do pull from Illinois. We, you know, Midwest, and then when people vacation, a lot of times we're on their list as a destination. So it is a wonderful zoo.
Well, and some of the improvements that you guys have made, I would say even in just the last decade, the new elephant enclosure, you've made so many improvements because I can remember going to the zoo in the 60s when I was a kid, and to see those old areas now, Jenny, is really, it's really an eye opener. to how the whole process of running a zoo, how that has changed over the decades.
Right. Like you say, very true. Zoos are now all about animal welfare, where in the past, and that's all we knew. We didn't know that in the past is what I should say. But we did the best that we could, like all other zoos. But like you say, the elephant enclosure now for them is, yes, 1.3 acres. They have their own self-activating shower. They have different enrichment items that they can reach up with their trunks and use some of the same behaviors that they would had they been out in the wild. And an interesting story about that is one of the keepers over there, the primary keeper, she said when they first got into that outdoor enclosure and they were, you know, let out and they were just acclimating towards it or whatever. And she goes, oh yeah. She's like, now what they're doing is they'll go to the furthest area near their watering hole. And she said, when I need to bring them in for the night, she said, they ignore me. She goes, I know them so well. They don't want to come in because they were enjoying their enclosure so much. I'm like, what do you mean? She's like, they're pretending like they don't hear me. You know, because they have different, you know, sounds.
Oh, they're teenagers.
Right. And I'm like, I thought that was so cool because it's like, that's what they needed. They needed this upgraded enclosure. And now we have a third elephant over there that has acclimated. So it's, you know, some of those things that, like you say, we've improved beyond what I ever imagined.
Yeah, so much. It's just, it's a wonderful, wonderful thing to see. And it's got to be very challenging but I know that the zoo's always had an incredible amount of support and supporters because you can't do this without that. You can't.
Right. Absolutely. And we always tell people, you know, your regular visitor, when they pay their admission, you are helping us bring animals here. You are directly related to raising funds for us. It's not just the big, you know, corporate donations. It's people that visit the zoo that can help us go on. And as you said, in the 1960s, we have one exhibit that's still here, the rhino exhibit, which if people remember sort of the indoor, you know, the paint is peeling somewhat. Sure. They need, so that is all, we're in the design phase of that now.
So cool.
And so it's going to be a wonderful, you know, outdoor, indoor, and also a new indoor area for the hippos. And we're hoping that that will open in 2025.
Wow.
So like you say, now we're addressing that, which is kind of the last of those sort of antiquated exhibits. So we're super excited about that and maybe breeding for rhinos in the future.
Oh, that's
so
great.
Very cool. We got a text from Pat. Very important question. You talk about all the animals that you have, but is there one animal that creeps you out at the zoo?
I'm going to get trouble. I'm going to get trouble from the aquatic and reptile keepers. But we have a new anaconda, and her name is Olive, and she's 110 pounds. And yeah.
That sounds like an old anaconda.
Well, she was actually at the Madison Zoo.
Yeah.
She's not terribly old, but she outgrew her enclosure. So they called us and said, if you have a habitat for her, it took five people to bring her in here because each person was carrying a portion of her body. And then our curator had her head because he said, if anything happens, I'm going to take the bullet.
Oh my God.
But you know, that those kind of animals, I've learned to appreciate her, but I have to say it creeps me out a little bit.
You can call her Olive all day. She's still a 110-pound anaconda. That's not gonna make me feel any warmer towards Olive.
Right. There's a lot of olives.
We only have a couple of minutes left, Jenny. You're retiring after almost 26 years at the Milwaukee County Zoo. I'm so happy for you. And I'm so happy that I've had the chance to work with you off and on over the years. We've had a lot of fun together. Is there any opportunity that they're going to name a creature after you? I think that would only be fair that there should be a Jenny something.
I think they should. But I think they might be a little gun shy because there was a Jersey cow that was named after me. Cutest calf, cutest cow. Then she grew up and she had a lot of intestinal problems. Poor cow. But we fixed her up. And now she lives with Farmer Joe out in the pastures. But I don't know if they want you. They're gun shy. You know what I mean? They're gun shy now that they named something Jenny. And
what if they renamed the anaconda Olive? They're like, this is Jenny, the 110-pound anaconda.
No.
Not the anaconda.
Honestly, they should honestly name a bird after you because they could call it Jennifer Deliberti.
That's true. And there's some really, I mean, maybe like a flamingo or something. Flamingos are pretty and tropical.
Who do we lobby for that, Jenny? We'll make this happen for you.
We talked to Bob Zoo up there.
Who do we need? The flamingo lobby is next on my list.
You're absolutely right. And I just wanted to say, Jane, what a huge supporter you have been in the past of the zoo. And you get it. Conservation and giving these animals such good homes. When I think back on, we had a Western lowland gorilla that her mother and father passed away unexpectedly. And so she needed to be hand raised. And those keepers were there 24/7 with her, pretending to be her mom and feeding her. I mean, sometimes these keepers see the animals more than they see their spouses.
I'm sure.
But it's a passion for them. And like you say, I mean, to be a supporter of that and to see, and we've done that with a number of animals. So we appreciate all the support and you as well, Greg. Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much. I love the zoo.
Thank you so very much, Jenny Deliberti. All good things to you going forward. I hope we will stay in touch and we'll learn more about the Milwaukee County Zoo going forward. Thanks again, Jenny. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Stay with us when we return. News is next. Entertainment news, Jon Stewart coming back.
Oh, boy.
All the details coming up. This is Matt Nair on air, coming to you on the Civic Media Radio Network. Tonight, hush, my darling, don't fear my darling, the lion sleeps tonight.
Doesn't seem to matter what I do, I'm always number two. No one knows how hard I tried.
Good morning. Welcome to Matt Nair on Air. Thank you so very much for joining us. Jane Matt Nair, Greg Bach, and Dr. Slide on the board, coming to you live from our studio in beautiful downtown Waukesha. You can always join us, call or text at 844-967-2789. Leave a comment on the live stream if you're watching on Facebook, YouTube, and or Twitter.
Oh, remember when you couldn't remember all three?
Yes.
And now it's just bam, 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 bam.
Now I'm never going to be able to get it out of my head.
Yeah, you're like waking up in the middle of the night, Twitter!
Stuck there forever. I want to do a little housekeeping before we move on.
Oh, yes,
Jenny, Jenny Deliberti was here, just here from the Milwaukee County
Zoo.
So
lovely.
Well, wonderful woman. I've known her for a long time, and she is going to be retiring after almost 26 years at the wonderful Milwaukee County Zoo, and she was sharing some stories about what happens behind the scenes and all of the anaconda and what it's been like. And you can just tell how much joy that job brought her.
Oh, my gosh, yes.
And still does.
Yes.
You know, just seeing her. And so we had a couple of comments on the text line from the 262. With the amount of monkey business Jenny sees, I bet she can't tell if she's working at the zoo or in Madison at the Capitol. There it is. Timing, Calvin. Timing. Another one. 110-pound anaconda, still not the biggest snake in Wisconsin. Hello, Ron Johnson.
Oh, Lord. We just need a real drum set in here. I'll just be on the drums the entire time. Oh, my gosh. We did get, also earlier in the show, we were talking about the NRA. Got a great text from Pat, again, who texted about the scary animals, but he also texted, nobody has offered thoughts and prayers for Wayne LaPierre.
That's
you're right.
True.
Let's take a moment. Just everybody bow your head and close your eyes. And we're going to give a moment of silence. All right. That's enough.
That's long enough.
Good.
Okay.
Good.
Moving along. We do have Mike Clemens is going to be joining us coming up at 11:50 for a little update. All kinds of sports news broke this morning. The Bucks have hired Doc Rivers now as their new head coach. And the Packers have fired Joe Barry as defensive coordinator. So Michael will be here to give us a little recap of that, how this all went down and what fans and teammates are saying about this.
Yeah.
Another big shakeup in the middle of the season. End of one season for the Packers and the middle of the season for the Milwaukee Bucks.
I mean, for Wisconsin sports, it doesn't seem like news broke. It seems like sports is broke.
That update coming up at 11:50. Want to go back to what we were talking about yesterday. We talked about the Oscar nominations that were announced.
Yes.
And this was pretty much, I saw this all over the place yesterday, even after we had talked about it. And the fact that Greta Gerwig and Margot Robbie from Barbie, Greta Gerwig was the director. She also co-wrote the screenplay with her husband. And then Margot Robbie was the star of Barbie.
And produced it.
And produced, yes.
Yes.
And Gerwig too, I think.
I believe Gerwig did, but yeah. Margot Robbie's production company took it on.
And neither of them were nominated for either Best Director or Best Actress. And it's just kind of amusing that Ryan Gosling did get nominated for Best Supporting Actor, even though without Barbie, there's no Ken.
The movie itself has provided content for all of the memes that have been coming out in the past 24 hours. Like there's a clip of Will Ferrell and all the guys in suits running down the beach. It says, you know, right now the Oscar committee looking to compliment Margot Robbie on a great job, but give Ryan Gosling the Oscar instead. Like, it's just, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. This movie is like, it was a satire of pop culture that got parodied, essentially, almost. I mean, it just, it's ridiculous and it's embarrassing.
Well, and he came out with a statement. Ryan Gosling came out with a statement after he was nominated. Quote, "There is no Ken without Barbie, and there is no Barbie movie without Greta Gerwig and Margot Robbie, the two people most responsible for this history-making, globally celebrated film. No recognition would be possible for anyone on the film without their talent, grift, and genius.
Grit.
Against all odds, with nothing but a couple of soulless, scantily clad, and thankfully crotchless dolls, they made us laugh. They broke our hearts. They pushed the culture. They made history. Their work should be recognized along with every other very deserving nominee."
And he gives America Ferrera a nice shout out,
yes,
too.
I mean, he does, it's just because she was nominated for Best Supporting Actress. She has a great speech in that movie.
It's like I said yesterday, I'll be interested to see if he wins, what he'll say on stage. But what I was expecting is what he just did. Like, I mean, there was no way that Ryan Gosling was going to be quiet, and there was no way Ryan Gosling wasn't going to take all of the credit and give it over to everyone who was just as much a part of this film, but like Margot Robbie and Greta Gerwig. Without them, this film probably wouldn't have been made.
Absolutely
or
not.
It wouldn't it, look like
it
this.
It would be a much different movie.
It'd be a toy movie.
Yes.
There would be no message in it.
You're right.
Yeah.
Yeah. That could have absolutely. And that's why the movie, though, did so well.
Over $1 billion.
Because it took such a different tack on this iconic toy.
Yeah.
Really. He also said, Ryan Gosling, "I'm extremely honored to be nominated by my colleagues alongside such remarkable artists in a year of so many great films. Best line of all. And I never thought I'd be saying this, but I'm also incredibly honored and proud that it's for portraying a plastic doll named Ken." Because he is quite an accomplished actor.
Oh my gosh, yes. He is phenomenal. There's honestly nothing he can't do. He can do drama. He can do comedy. He can do slapstick. He can do intense. I mean, he's just, and at the end of the day, like every time he's interviewed, every time he wins an award, he always has the most grace, the most class, the nicest things to say about people. And he is almost infuriatingly funny. He's got that Canadian dry wit. He has when people make jokes, he makes good faces. Like, he's just a guy I want to, like, be like, thanks
hang
for
with?
Being cool. I don't even want to hang with him. I'm like, what will we do? Like, I'm sorry. I'm here, and you're Ryan Gosling. I'll leave you alone.
Other entertainment news coming out this morning. Jon Stewart coming back to Comedy Central.
Yep. Who'd have thunk?
They've looking for months for a new host on Comedy Central, so they reached out to Jon Stewart. He will be hosting on Monday nights throughout the 2024 election cycle, and he will oversee programming through 2025.
Yes, he'll be the executive producer. Now,
I'm glad he's back. You know, that's cool. And I know that they'll also be using when they don't have John, as far as
other correspondents.
Yeah, they'll be acting as host. They'll be acting as, you know, the MC of the show. But let's not forget, there were two very qualified candidates for the host of The Daily Show that Comedy Central passed on. And the fact that they did that shot themselves in their own foot.
Who did they blow it with?
Well, first of all, I mean, when you want to talk about outside, well, former correspondent, Hasan Minhaj.
Who was great.
Who was amazing. When he hosted that week, you could tell every episode he was on, every moment he was working on that show, he was saying, I want this show. And I thought he would have made a great host. And because of that hit piece in The New Yorker, he debunked himself, which I thought was awful. Comedy Central passed. He was on the shortlist, and they passed on him. And then, okay, don't take Hasan. Roy Wood Jr.,
yeah,
who is a comedic genius, who loves that show, has a background in journalism. He would have been an amazing choice. They said no to him, and they said, no, we're going to keep looking. And they lost Hasan, and Roy Wood Jr. said, have a good day.
Yeah, goodbye.
Yep, and I think Roy Wood Jr. is going to do amazing things. He is, I'm not kidding you, he's one of the funniest comedians alive. If you have the Paramount Plus, all three of his specials are there.
Cool.
I tell you to watch them. You will laugh so hard.
Texter from the 262 says, Jon Stewart could host a Daily Show airing 24/7, and it still couldn't cover all of the absurdity coming from the current GOP.
Oh, absolutely.
I just think he is whip smart.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing gets past him.
Nope. No.
And his ability to retain facts is astonishing to
me. Yeah. It's like he has this, like this thing of like, I'm having a conversation with you. It's like chess almost when he, I don't want to say speaks to someone who's wrong or whatnot, but when he speaks to someone who he has questions for, it's like, I'm going to ask you a question. If you give me this answer, I know my answer will be this. But if you give me that answer, I know I can pivot to this. And he does it with such ease.
Yeah. And so it's seamless.
He's never like searching for notes or going, blah, 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 blah. No. He's just writing. I mean, the interview with the state rep about guns.
Oklahoma. He was from Oklahoma.
And the Arkansas, I believe it was the AG?
I believe so. The Attorney General about trans kids.
Yep. Those are two of the best interviews I've ever seen in my entire
life. Yes, I agree with you. And if you, and this is from The Problem with Jon Stewart, which is no longer on. That was an Apple Plus thing. If you can find that video of Jon Stewart talking to this gun rights advocate lawmaker in Oklahoma, it's brilliant.
It's brilliant and infuriating.
Yep, at the same time.
Yep.
Speaking of slightly infuriating, I'm not sure how you feel about this. I used to be a big fan. I have lost my enchantment with Bill Maher.
You were a fan of his?
I was a fan of his. I really was. For a long time, in the last couple of years, not so very much. But he will be coming to town at the Riverside Theater July 14th. It just happens to be the day before the RNC kicks off.
Yay. Cool.
He certainly has a following. He's been on HBO with Real Time for a really long time.
Yeah, that's great. I just don't. I've never found his stand-up funny. I'll say it.
Never
found his stand-up funny. And I liked Politically Incorrect back in the 90s. That was a fun show. But he's just turned into a guy who now believes his own hype. He's not my jam. He stopped being my jam a long time ago. I stopped respecting him when he made Religious. And
that's interesting.
Because I am a non-believer. And you'd think that movie would be right up my alley. And I watched that movie and I'm like, oh, you're just making fun of people who are like make a movie about the hypocrisy, make a movie about the high echelons of religion, but he's making fun of people who are just believers.
Who just believe what they believe.
Who have no real power. And their religion is their heart. And I don't know. It just seems like ducks in a barrel.
It was punching down.
Yeah, exactly.
It was punching down. And really, for someone of his stature, you punch up. You don't take the easy cheap shots.
And
I can see your point on that. It was kind of a letdown. It could have been a much fuller investigation. Yeah.
And his Islamophobia has gotten really bad, in my opinion. So, you know, it doesn't surprise me that he's in town for the RNC. He'll be here doing a show. That'll be an interesting week for the Laughing Tap.
Oh, yes, it will.
We're already trying to secure some names.
Are you?
We're working because we'll be a comedy club right in the thick of it. And
I hadn't even thought about that.
Oh, yeah. We've been thinking about it. We've been thinking about it since the DNC was supposed to come to town. Remember that?
I do.
Remember when that was supposed to happen?
Yes, I do. And there were a lot of people who were disappointed that didn't happen. Of course, it was a, small issue of a global pandemic.
I'm really angry about it.
What are you going to do?
Yeah, exactly.
All right. When we return, Civic Media sports guy Mike Clemens is going to join us. All kinds of news in the sports world this morning. The Packers firing defensive coach Joe Beery. A lot of people.
Defensive or offensive? Defensive
coach.
You're right. Sorry.
Joe Beery.
So much sports.
I barely know what I'm talking about when I talk about sports. Don't screw me up like
I'm
that.
I'm sorry. Talk more about the throw ball.
The throw ball. Mike Clemens will be here to clarify things and talk about sports balls and more. Stay close. You're listening to Matt Nair on Air. This is the Civic Media Radio Network. Matt Nair on Air. Thank you so very, very much for joining us. Jane Matt Nair, Greg Bach, and Calvin coming to you live from our studio in beautiful downtown Waukesha. You can always join us, call or text at 844-967-2789, 844-96-PARTY. Or leave a message on the live stream on Facebook, YouTube, and or Twitter. Big sports news this morning, Joe Beery out as defensive coordinator for the Green Bay Packers. He is all over the state covering sports for Civic Media, joining us now on the phone, Michael Clemens. Good morning, Mike. Thanks for squeezing us in today. Big news. Are you surprised about this Joe Beery announcement? I'm sure a lot of Packers fans are like, "This, my Christmas wish finally came true."
Yeah, you know, hi, Jane and Greg. You know, the Packers had a couple of bad games. One in particular was, actually two. They lost to the Giants, a struggling team on Monday Night Football. And then they lost to Baker Mayfield, kind of an overhyped quarterback. He's now with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. They actually ended up making it into the playoffs. But they lost to him at Green Bay. And, you know, there were some things that they were doing, the Buccaneers are doing. They kept on throwing passes to a wide-open Chris Godwin. And that's when the fans said, okay, we've had enough of this. We've seen this a couple of times where it seems like the opponents have a wide-open receiver. When they played the Vikings, Justin Jefferson, their star receiver, seemed to go uncovered. And the players, you know, made a few rumblings about it in the locker room. And so, you know, he's kind of been under the spotlight for a year. I knew things were at that next level of, you know, under the microscope because I was at the preseason game in Cincinnati with the Packers. And just before the kick, when they've got the Skyline chili there laid out there in the press box, I see Joe Beery loading up and getting some Skyline chili. It's like, the game starts in 5 minutes. Should you be downstairs?
Oh.
And that's when I discovered, oh, wait a minute. So I asked LaFleur after the game. I said, is Joe Beery moved upstairs? Yeah, it's something we're trying out. So you see, the head coach had moved him from the sidelines, where their players are, to upstairs so he could see the game better. So that's when you start seeing, saying, okay, we need to reexamine how you're doing things during a game.
I'm surprised he lasted that long then, because honestly, Mike, one of the things I'd been saying for the past couple of weeks was that, you know, as Jane put it, his head had been called for to be put on a platter for a while, but they'd had some wins, so maybe, all right, things are starting to look.
It might have been safe.
Might have been safe, but obviously not. And there, wow, okay.
You know, it even got to the point where after the 49ers game over the weekend, which was just, you know, an incredible game to be at and to cover. Matt LaFleur did his end-of-season press conference early this week because he knew that some of these changes were going to be on the way. So he said, I haven't talked to anybody yet. I'm talking to you guys. Any questions you've got about the season or Saturday night's game, and then we've got to get to work. And that means that he's going to interview some key players, some team captains, All right, what do you think? Now the door's open. You can say whatever you want before you go off to your off-season. And he probably got some feedback there. LaFleur also said, you know, if necessary, I may give up play calling duties to my offensive coordinator, Adam Stanovich.
Wow.
Which is like, what? So LaFleur is trying to cover for himself as well. Like, you know, I'm doing everything I can. I'm keeping an open mind. Now, who is going to be a candidate for it? We don't really know. I don't think there's anybody within the organization that they want to promote, although Jerry Montgomery, a defensive line coach, is a very articulate guy. But at the end of the day, you guys remember the TV series MASH?
Oh, sure.
Never heard of it.
Okay. So you got Hawkeye and the other guy. Do you remember Major Frank Burns?
Heck yes. Yeah.
That's Joe Barry.
Right. Ooh.
Oh, God.
He knows everything. He's all football and everything like that. But there's just something always a little fake about him. Very nice guy. Tries to be very positive. But, like, you know, after they beat the Cowboys with that huge upset, I was standing outside the locker room, and I see Joe and the other coaches that are upstairs now. They're coming down the elevator, and they're walking by. And just as there's about 20 or 30 of us reporters standing here waiting for the next thing when they're going to open the doors and let us talk to players and coaches and stuff, Joe comes by and out loud says, "All right, we're still blanket alive. Yeah, we did it." Like, how fake is that? You know, you don't, right?
That's weird.
Would you guys, you know, after you get the ratings book, would you walk by the sales office and say aloud, "Wow, how about those ratings for the show? That's just tremendous, huh?" You know, it was that kind of a thing. It's those kinds of things where I think he probably is getting pushed out because of the people skills.
Michael Clemens is our guest. Mike, we got about 2.5 minutes left. Doc Rivers, he is in as Bucks head coach.
I want to tell you a quick story. Adrian Griffin was hired by the Bucks, and he told me one-on-one. I said, "So how'd you find out you got hired?" His first chance now as an NBA head coach, as a player, and years as an assistant. And he said, he turns to the PR guy and says, "Can I tell this?" He goes, "Yeah." He said, "I'd had meetings all week with the Bucks," and he says, "and then my agent called me Friday morning and says, we've got another meeting. I think we're at the one-yard line. I think, don't blow this meeting. I think they're going to offer us the job." So he goes in there, and he's sitting there, and he's there with the owner, Wes Edens, and John Horst, the GM, and the other guys. And they're just having a happy chat, and then all of a sudden, Eden keeps on looking at his phone, and then finally, when ESPN posts Adrian Griffin, new head coach in Milwaukee, he says, "Well, if ESPN's got it, then it must be true." And he shows him his phone, and that's how he finds out, which I think is creepy.
That's weird. Jinx.
Yeah.
That is really an odd way to handle that.
49-year-old man. He's worked his whole life. He finally gets to this pinnacle. He'd actually worked for the Bucks for a year, several years ago.
Yeah.
But he told me that story, and he thought it was kind of a special moment. I thought, dude, that's a weird way to be told. You tell that person in person. It's an important moment in a guy's life.
That just sounds like communication. Like release this in 20 minutes. They're like, "All right, I'll release it right now."
Yeah, that was bad form.
Yeah.
That was definitely bad form. All right, Michael. Doc Rivers, any feelings real quickly?
Yeah, experienced guy. He's being brought in to help their defense, which is, you know, has not improved. He will get through to these veterans and do some yelling and screaming.
Good, because those boys need a Need a talk.
They need a good scolding. Michael Clemens covers sports for Civic Media. He is all over the state and all over the country. Thank you so very much, Michael. Appreciate you making time.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you, Jane.
We have news coming up next, followed by the wonderful Todd Allbosch Show. Stay close. Thank you for listening and calling and texting sincerely. And I hope you find some joy today and you have the chance to share it. Stay here. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network.